That Dini,
I'd begin like to extending my warm greetings to all of you who are listening to the internet. Today I'd like to speak to you about the 29th and the 30th good deeds from the Autobiographical Verses Good Deeds by Mikyo Dorje. Now, there's a commentary on the meaning of these autobiographical verses by the Lama Sanje Paldrip. And so if we combine the outline from that with the text, then how it goes is, as I will show you. Among the three different types of individuals, we're in the passage speaking about the practice of the greater individual. This has three parts: the intention arousing bodhicitta, the action meditating the two types of bodhicitta, and how he trained in the precepts of the two types of bodhicitta. So there are these three sections, and among them, we're speaking about the third, how he trained in the precepts of the two types of bodhicitta. Now, this training the precepts of the two types of bodhicitta has seven subtopics. We've spoken about the first, how he trained in the six transcendents, the second, how he trained in the purifying his own continuum, and the third, how he trained in all the ways of bodhicitta. So today we're speaking about the fourth, how he acted in accord with time and place. And this is the point that we have come to. We speak about how he acted in accord with the time and place. The root text for this reads this, like this. In the degenerate age, few are they who serve the Buddha's teachings, and those to be served have not entered the teachings properly. Seeing that, I tried even harder to tame myself. I think of this as one of my good deeds. So among the seven different ways he trained in the various precepts, this is the fourth, and it's the 29th of the good deeds. Now, so this 29th good deed, so if we speak about this according to Mikyo Dorje's text called The Instructions and Training in His Liberation Story, which is found as collected work. Now, this is a text that Mikyo Dorje himself wrote. And this is something, if someone wants to take Mikyo Dorje as a guru and follow his example, he says, this is my liberation story. If you follow this example of my life story in this way, then it is good. So it's a collection of advice and direction that he had given. So it's explaining his life story as spiritual advice. And what it says in this is that in general, there are many people who haven't entered the Buddhist teachings. They're not Buddhist at all. They haven't entered the Mahayana Dharma at all, and they don't practice the Mahayana Dharma. And among all of these different people, now this is when you're looking at it, you're looking at how it looks on the outside. Now, of course, we can't really tell whether they're practicing the Mahayana Dharma or not, or they're practicing Buddhism or not. We can't really know for the example. But when you look on the outside, it seems they don't seem to be Buddhist, and they don't seem to be Mahayana practitioners. So but even among them, it's quite possible that there are people among them who do great things on behalf of the teachings. But these are things that we ordinary people cannot understand or see. And we look at it from the outside, they're not Buddhist, they aren't practicing Mahayana, but in actuality, it could well be someone who actually is practicing the Buddha Dharma, is actually someone who's really doing the true practice of the Buddhist teachings. It's possible that it might be someone who actually practices the Mahayana teachings. But it's difficult for regular people to understand this. So this means what Ashutama is actually holding the teaching. But it's difficult to include such people among the upholders of the teachings. I mean, because someone who's upholding the teachings, it's difficult for us to understand whether these people are actually upholding the teachings or not. But when we talk about someone upholding the teachings, that means someone who, within the sphere of our own perception, someone who, when we look at it, we can understand. We can say, oh, they are Buddhist. They are Mahayana practitioners. And this is the people who generally accept to uphold the Mahayana and who to be Buddhist. And so the individuals who uphold the teacher and like that are what the people who we call the people who uphold the teachings. But there are two types of these people. The people who actually uphold the teachings, who actually uphold the teachings as they say they do, and then there are the people who seem to practice, or the pseudo-upholders of the teachings. The outside, it looks like they're upholding the teachings, but in actuality, they don't really properly practice the Dharma. There are some people like this, of course. And so for both of them, whether someone who's actually upholding the teaching or is a pseudo-upholder of the Dharma, so whichever the song of this might be, they need to be included as people who are upholding the Dharma. You need to consider that they must be upholding the teaching the sutras of the sutras and tantra, the three vehicles. And they say that they're practicing enough teaching this, and so they need to be included. Both of these types need to be included in the upholders of the teachings. And so the sanghas of such beings should be included in the sangha, or the foundation for the teachings. And so there's, of course, the ordinary, the actual upholders of teachings are so, but for those who are only pseudo-upholders of the Dharma, even though they can't actually practice the Dharma themselves, because they have that image, or they seem to be doing it in that way, because they're doing this, at least we should consider that they're important and great beings. Now, this is maybe it's one being like a little bit over zealous, but on the, or there's no other choice, but on the other hand, is that they really are doing this. And so when we look at them, so then among the upholders of the teachings, there are people of different views, like within the sutra practice, you know, there's different ways you pick up your vajra, there are different ways you pick up your vajra bell. And so in the sama, you need to take on this, if you need to do it one way, and the sama one day, the new one. So the different ways you can even place your vajra bell down. In Tibet, they need to the different hats that there were. They have different heads, different colors, different shapes. And so there are different styles of hats that people wear. And likewise, within the Vinaya, between the upper and the lower of Vinaya, there are different ways of tying your robes. And so there are these minor differences that happen there. So there are these bit of minor differences, and because of this, what we can... see that there's not a whole lot of difference in actuality in terms of the Tibetan Buddhism, but when you look at it on the outside, there's some little differences. And because of this, we something that they're completely different, that they're separate. But actually, this is a mistake. In actuality, within our Tibetan teachings, if we're taking Tibetan Buddhism as a basis, there's not a whole lot of actual. There are a few little differences here and there. Even within the Kagyus, there are quite a few little differences here and there. But that alone does not make them completely different or separate. In any case, we think that there is sort of differences or discord between the two different lineages. We see the only particular features of our own. But the really powerful and courageous bodhisattvas, When they see these variations and traditions, they say that there are ways for the roots of virtue to increase. They want to, and they strive very hard to make all the different traditions flourish. And the reason why they work so hard to do this is that is when you have different views and conduct, and even the different styles of hats, just that is because of the different, you know, the sentient beings have different capacities and faculties, and they're different. These are just different ways to help them. So this happens, right? Some people, and if you're wearing a Nyingma style like this, some people, it just really looks good to them. Some people, when you put the kaju style hats, then the people look, they really like the way it looks. And some people, don't like the way they do wear their design. And if you say that if you don't like wearing the kaju style hats and you assist someone, does it, it becomes a very difficult situation. The other person is very kind of uncomfortable feeling, feels uncomfortable about it. I remember this once. I remember when we first had the Kaju Mulam, when we were reforming the monastic conduct, and we had a meeting at Gyutu. And at that time, Kyabje Vajradhara Tenka Rinpoche was present. He was at Gyutu at that time, and representatives of all the different Kaju monasteries came, and we had a meeting. And during the meeting, we spoke about what sort of hats we should wear during the Munlam. And at that time, I said that we should wear the crested hats. These are the yellow hats that we are, right? I think I said it's good to wear them. During the time of the 7th, 8th, and 9th Karmapas, there was a tradition of wearing such these yellow-crested hats. And likewise, the earliest explanation of the crested hats, these yellow hats, was written by the 4th Shamarabha Chodak Yeshe. And I haven't seen any earlier than that. I believe it's the earliest. Even when the Gelugpa masters describe the way it's wore, they quote the 4th Shamar Chodak Yeshe. And so wearing these crested yellow hats is an old Kaju lineage. And then we talk about the history of the yellow hats. It's talking about, it's related to the revival of the Vinaya teachings in Tibet. And since it's related to that history, so because I thought it was good because it was connected with the history of the revival of the Vinaya. And when I said this, no, I didn't say anything right at that time. But that evening, some of the senior monks came and said, "There's a yellow hat, this yellow hat. We shouldn't have to wear that. We should wear the, we have the shata, the multicolored hat, the kamsang hat. This is our own particular. It's best to wear that. The yellow crested hat just isn't so good," they said. Many people, when they think about it, they think that it means related to the Gelugpa order, because we have this habit of thinking so, but actually, historically, it's not actually like that. But in sort of like in our old tradition, there were ways to speak. People get a lot of uncomfortable, and so in the evening, a few of the senior ones came to me and they said, "And probably better to wear the multicolored hat than the yellow hat," they said. But I insisted that we wear the crested hat. And I've explained the reasons, and I don't have anything else to say about that. At that time, I hadn't seen the text by the fourth Sharma, but later when I did read it, I felt more confident about it. And I said to them, "Before I said you should wear them," and I said, "Here is a source for saying it." And I was able to explain it.
But
in any case, because of the different types of students, you have the different hats and the different styles and colors. And sometimes people like them or don't like them. If we want to be completely non-sectarian and spreading the teachings, then this is a great action in the behalf of the teachings. And it's a really excellent way to gather the accumulation of merit. Likewise, if you can provide the Sangha of all 10 directions with the provisions that they need for practicing Dharma, and this is actually even greater virtue than making offerings to the Buddhas. And the reason for this is that among the three jewels, it said that only the Sangha is the excellent field, the field or the recipients of offerings. Among the three jewels, the greatest recipient or field for offerings is the Sangha. This is the best one, they say. Now, the reason why this is the best recipient is that when you make an offering to the Sunams, there's the merit of making the offering and also the merit of them accepting the offering. When you make an offering to the Dharma and the Buddha, then there's the merit of offering, but none of them are actually accepting or using. Now, reason is that when you provide the practicing Dharma, they're having the proper ones that are not related to a wrong livelihood. So providing that Sangha supplies for practicing Dharma helps preserve the pure Dharma and supports the activity of the great beings who uphold the teachings, and therefore helps preserve the teaching, and then it prevents the lineage of the Buddha's teachings, like the Buddha's family. It's like you've got the family line, or you could say the line of awareness, the lineage from the Buddha. And so in this way, preventing the Sangha with the supplies for practicing the Dharma is extremely important and is a great source of virtue. And so for that reason, if we think that we want the teachings of the teachings to preserve the teachings for a long time in the world, and we want the Dharma to remain a long time in the world, if we have that hope, then we need to make offerings to the jewel of the Sangha. This is very important. Making offerings to the jewel of the Sangha, as I said just before, yeah, the jewel of the Sangha. From one perspective, they're actually within the Sangha, the people who are actually upholding the teachings, who are naturally or truly upholding it. And then there are people who pretend to be upholding the teachings. They're both. But both of them, we should consider both of them to be important, it is said. And I'll get to the reason later. I can give a more detailed explanation of that later. And Mikyo Dorje himself, that's what it says in Mikyo Dorje's own instructions in following his liberation story. When Sanjit Paltrup says in his commentary on the meaning, what he says, in this age when the five degenerations are rampant, so we talk about the five degenerations of degenerate time, degeneration of lifespan, degenerate views, degenerate beings, degeneration of the afflictions. These are the five afflictions. That's one. Likewise, there's also a commentary on the Vinaya Sutras by Vimalamitra. And here they're called the five pollutions. It's a different translation, probably. When translated from Sanskrit, it's just a difference. They're called the five pollutions. So whether you call them the five degenerations or the five pollutions, they're actually the meaning is the same. It's a question that you've come to a bad time. And so we had the script teaching the scripture. These are the three baskets of the scriptures, and the teaching of the rituals are the practice of the three trainings. And the people who have these scriptures, teach a scripture, whether they're someone who is a lay person or a bhikshu, These are, and generally we talk about the four communities of the teachings, and the we have the bhikkhus and the lay and female lay preceptors for the lay people, and then we have the bhikkhus and bhikkhunis among the monastics. Likewise, there are also representations of the three jewels and temples and like statues and paintings, and all of these are actually, like real superior objects, something that we should see as being sacred and important. And it is important for us to see them as being important. However, in the past, during the time of Mikyo Dorje's life, and particularly also in our current day, many people don't see them as being important or sacred. And in particular, during the time of Mikyo Dorje's life, the representations of the three jewels and temples, in addition to people just didn't take care of their temples, and they would let them become decrepit, and the monastics, and they were not allowed to keep monastic rules. Sometimes they were made to go to war, and this happened quite a few times in the old days. So it's talked about the yellow armies, where they would say to the monks, you have to go fight. You have to go fight in a war. And they'd send the monks into battle. This did happen. Also, they'd make people plow fields or fight or work in houses and so forth. In other words, they put the Sangha to work. Actually, they're supposed to practice the Dharma. You should have them practice the Dharma, but instead of letting them practice the Dharma, instead you put them to work in agriculture or building houses or fighting in wars and so forth. And they're made to do various different things. They're sent to them, do this, and they're given a few little gifts. And when they're given gifts, because at that time the lifestyle, the general, it was not a very prosperous time. The people at that time, in order to go to school, you had to practice this. You had to do whatever in order to appease the people who gave you. You had to do whatever. Some people would even have to sacrifice their lives for this. And so some people, it's like in order to appease the kings or the people, then they would be given big gifts. And when they're given a big gift, then they get really attached to the gift, and then they'd give up on all their actions of body, speech, of the listening, contemplation, meditation, and then they'd do whatever the kings, the monasteries, king and the ministers, and do whatever they said. And so the people who actually practiced Dharma properly were as rare than stars in the daytime. Like when the sun is shining, you can't see any stars in the sky, right? So that was the situation it was. And likewise, there were also the old tradition of practice study that had been there from the past, but they didn't preserve them or maintain them. Likewise, they'd also sometimes collect some funds for annual pujas and the regular pujas. So during the times when there are kings or ministers who are giving, like some starting establishment fund. So it might be someday they would give a field to support it, and they'd waste it all. And they'd seize the funds or the resources that were intended to support pujas and other monsters for themselves. And they'd take everything that was money to be supported to respond, and they'd support it. And they would destroy monasteries and so forth. And there were a lot of disputes between the different schools. They would almost go to fight, and they would take each other's fields and money. They'd destroy the temples. And they take the good pieces of wood and stone and bring it off to their own monastery to fix it up. Now this did happen. It doesn't need to say much about it. So forget about the Dharma. Even in this world, So we're in a situation where it's almost impossible to find people who are able to remain impartial, even in just worldly affairs. And so among them, the people who have like consider others as more important themselves and practice bodhicitta, even if you circumnavigated the entire world, you probably wouldn't find anyone. This is the terrible time. It was that time. This is in Mikkhya Dorje's time when this is said. And so for this reason, Mikkhya Dorje himself saw that there's a real decline in Tibetan Buddhism. Think in terms of the in any of the different teaching practice or the activity, there's a great degeneration, and so he had greater, even greater courage and greater resolve, and he had great compassion. And because he had such great compassion and great resolve, instead he didn't waste much time. He didn't ever waste any time in laziness. He had this great resolve of working on the behalf of teaching the students, and he had this great devotion. And so at any time, he was doing something for the sake of beings and teachings. And he always worked very hard at this. And among all the things he did for the benefit of teachings, and the best way to do this, he saw, was for himself to practice the Buddha's Dharma properly, as it should be practiced. If he was able to practice this himself, if he was able to practice the Mahayana Dhamma properly himself, and the practice of all three Vajras, and if he was able to refrain from everything that was contrary to that, give up all of the obscurations that should be overcome, then because of doing this, then many people would train in Mikkhya Dorje's example. And become able to practice the Dharma properly. To give an example of this, what the Buddha himself said, this is a saying, an actual saying that the Buddha said. My disciples who practice, if they practice Dharma, then train properly and practice the Dharma properly, then in the future, when there's famine and drought, when there's not even enough of a field, even the size of your fingernail that you could plant, if all of the fields are destroyed and there's not even the space of ground the size of a fingernail that can be planted, but even in such a time, the monastics who practice the Dharma will not go without food nor go without clothing to wear. They will not expect you such difficulty if you're actually practicing the Dharma. You don't need to worry about there is ever being a danger of running out of provisions to practice. And the reason, if you practice the Dharma properly, then even if human beings are unable to provide you with what you need, then the yakshas and local deities and other non-human beings will be able to provide them from being. They'll be able to provide them with their livelihood, give them food and clothing and so forth. In other words, if you're practicing Dharma properly, you don't need to worry about freezing death or dying of hunger or thirst. So mainly this is talking about practicing the Dharma practice. Practice the Dharma properly yourself, and if you do this, then we don't need to have a lot of thoughts or doubts or hopes or fears. So that's basically completes the 29th of the good deeds. Then following this is the 30th good deed. Now the 30th good deed here. If we talk about it in terms of the outline, the fifth session is how he acted in fruitful and fruitless situations. So the first is, there are two sections. The first is how he practiced, how he did what is fruitful. And so in terms of how he did what is fruitful, the root text reads, the teacher himself highly praised acts of virtue done in the time of the final 500 years. For the sake of mere reflection of the teaching, so I worked for the Sangha of scholars and meditators. I think of this as one of my good deeds. So among the 33 good deeds, oh, there's a mistake here. This is the 30th of the good deeds. It's not the 29th, it's the 30th. I made a mistake there. So there's a typo there, so that'll show to you again. So this is the 30th. The teacher himself highly praised acts of virtue done in the time of the final 500 years for the sake of the mere reflection of the teaching. So I worked for the Sangha of scholars and meditators. I think of this as one of my good deeds. So if we describe this as it is discussed in Sāgyāpāda's commentary in the meeting, this is what we call, the last 500-year period. Now we said the last 500-year period, this is related to the duration of the teachings, so that the teachings will list, how long the teachings will remain. There is discussion on the sutras and the tantras of how many years the teachings will remain. And this is called the duration of the teachings. And in the Vinaya, it speaks about the teachings would remain for 1,000 years. And so it mentioned this in the Vinaya, but it never speaks, it doesn't say anything about the teachings remaining 5,000 years. This is according to the Tibetan Vinaya. But there's also a sutra called the Sutra of Noble Maitreya, the Noble Sutra of Maitreya. It's in the Kanjura. And I think it's only a Lhasa Kanjura. I don't think it's in the Dharyat Kanjura. But in the Lhasa Kanjura, there's the Noble Sutra of Maitreya. And I think it was translated by the great Sakya Pandita. And there's also a great commentary by the master Haribhadra. And within his commentaries, he states that the teachings will remain for 5,000 years. We talk about the teachings remaining for 5,000 years. And this is divided into four main parts. And the four parts or periods are, first we have the three periods of results, and these three are each 500 years long, so that's a total of 1,500 years. And then there are the three periods for the trainings. So the three trainings, right? And for each of the trainings, there are 500 for each. And so for that reason, the previous one had 1,500, so you add another 1,500, so that gives a total of 3,000. Then after that, there are the three periods of the three baskets. These are the Sutras, Vinaya, and Abhidharma, right? And so for each of these three baskets, there are 500 years each. And so that's in addition to the 3,000 before, then that gives you a total of 4,500. And then there's the period of merely wearing robes, a total of 5,000 years. This is a total of 5,000 years that the teachings will remain, it is said. Now, what the teachings are remaining or not, what is the dividing line for this? Now, within the Vinaya, it does give a threshold from the teachings are present or not. when the rituals of actions are performed or not, in a particular when they're done assiduously. And so it speaks about this, and this is spoken about in the Uttaragantra, one of the Vinaya scriptures. It says, Venerable, that is the Buddha, how long will there be the true Buddha? When will it perish? And to explain the meaning of this, so it's like, how long will the Buddha, and how is it, when will the Buddha, when would, can we say that the Buddha, that the Dharma is perished? And the answer that the Buddha gave was, as long as the actions are performed and done assiduously, the teachings are present. If the rituals of the actions are not done, and then they're not done assiduously, then the true Dharma will have perished. When I'm talking about doing the rituals of actions, this is primarily speaking about the Vinaya, the practices of the Vinaya. These are the rituals and the practices of the Vinaya. This is what we primarily understand with this. In particular, we mean the rituals of the three basic rituals. And so there has to be a practice of them, and not only is it practice, but it also be done assiduously. That means that people are taking interest in it, and people have some enthusiasm about practicing. And if, as long as there is, then the teachings are remaining. And if we aren't doing the three basic practices of the rituals of the three basic practices, and we're not doing asudras, if they're not, and if we're not taking interest in them, and we don't have a lot of desire to practice them, and then we can say that the teacher has perished. And so this is what is said in the Vinaya. So nowadays, we're talking about the last period of 500 years, so we're talking about 5,000 years, where are we? Among the 5,000 years, where are we? Now, there are many different explanations of this. However, it's been over 2,500 years since the Buddha appeared. Now, in terms of when the Buddha actually was born, it's something we can't settle with 100% accuracy. And so, we aren't able to we aren't able to absolutely determine when he was born, but we can say that basically around 2,500 or over 2,500 years, we can say. And so in terms of this, from the time the Buddha passed into Parinirvana, there's been only about 2,500 years. And so for that reason, in terms of that, some lamas say that we're in the end of the last 500 years, but if it's only been only about, since we only have 2,500 years since the Buddha passed, if we take that, then we are not yet at that last period of only merely winding ropes. It's difficult to say we've got to that period, but this is something we need to consider, but I shan't say too much about it right now. But in any case, we say we've come to the last 500 years. If you take into the four main sections, there's the last 500 period of the period of results. There's a past 500 period of that. For the period of the three trainings, there's the last 500 years. From the period of the three baskets, there are last 500 years. And so you can't say that there's just one. So the last 500 years doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be the period of merely wearing the robes, because each of the sections has its own last 500 years. You can say that there are three or four of these last periods of 500 years. But in any case, we've come to that time. And so at that time, now in terms of this commentary, the commentary is, if we think about this commentary, he understands it as being the last period of merely wearing the robes. But if we compare it to the actual year the Buddha's passing away, it's difficult to say that. In any case, we've come to the era when there's just been a mere reflection of the teachings. And so we've come to an age when there's just merely a reflection of the teachings. Then it's like not only is the actual teaching losing, but even the mere image of the teaching is losing, the mere appearance of the teaching system, because they've come to an age where the mere robes and signs, and people are not even wearing the monastic robes. Instead, they're wearing lay robes. And they get in disputes and fights with each other. Like with the sponsors. When people offer these offerings to the Sangha, they don't even recite the sutra for purifying offerings or make dedications. And they don't recall the words, the three jewels every day. They don't even remember them from once a month or once a year. And so a lot of this, and so we talk about the three jewels. If people go many days without ever hearing the word, the three jewels, so this is a situation that we have come to now. So for that reason, Mikyo Dorje himself, his action, the example and the liberation he gave was that at that time, Mikyo Dorje always studied the sutras and tantras and the commentaries in mind. And so because he understood them well, the way he thought was that the Buddha himself, Buddha Bhagavan, said that in the future, when they're not actual teachings, but there is just a mere reflection of the Dharma, when you've come to that time, then you need to uphold that mere reflection and preserve that, then that is also a vast amount of virtue. Even if there's only a mere image or reflection of the teachers, then even if the Sangha is not able to keep their precepts, and the people who appear to be Dharma practitioners are actually really able to practice Dharma as it should be practiced, when there's a time when there's just a mere image or reflection of the teachings, and even that mere image of the Dharma, if there's just that mere image of the Dharma, then it's extremely important to properly protect this image of the Dharma. And if you do this, then there's really no greater merit than that. The reason for this is that even if you're unable to practice the teaching properly, if you're able to uphold the teachings, then it helps people to decrease people's afflictions. And it helps increase people's, ripen people's faculties and capacities. And so for this reason, the Buddha himself, that even if we aren't able to practice the Dharma, our actual Dharma, then even if we're unable to keep all the monastic precepts, if we at least have the appearance of a monastic, and if we're able to uphold this and to continue to hold that, then there's extremely great benefit, he said. And this is, and the Buddha said this, and Mikyo Dorje understood that the Buddha had said this. And then so he established shadras and for study, the three tributes, and he started practice centers to practice the three trainings. So even if they're unable to practice things truly, then if they're not able to practice it genuinely or the way they were practiced from the teachings when Buddhism was flourishing, even if you're unable to establish such great monasteries and nunneries like as it was at that time, but even if there's just a mere image of them, it's still very important. In understanding this, he established monasteries for the monastics, and he provided them with the worldly and Dharma things that they need. So Mikyo Dorje himself had studied with many different lamas and studied much Dharma with them, and not only did he under that, he also, in order to benefit, he also taught quite a bit of Dharma. And because of this, he had many students, and these students went to different places and they built new monasteries, they established new Sangha communities. And so there are many such activities that occurred. And not only that, Mikyo Dorje himself would provide these monks and support communities of study and practice, or monasteries. And he also built many statues and representations of the Buddha Sangha and Buddha Dharma Sangha. These are described in many of Mikkyo Dorje's Nampas, but one of these, but the most important is there is a text, there's a list called a text called the List of the Mikkyo Dorje's Accomplishments that is in the that's written, recorded in text. And the person who wrote this down is by a director of the district of Namgya Drama. And the person who recorded to write this, so he asked Mikkyo Dorje to write this text, to write this list of Mikkyo Dorje's accomplishments. And within this, Mikkyo Dorje himself, he describes the gurus that he followed, the students whom his students were, the monasteries that he founded, what representations of body, speech, and mind he wrote, and so forth. He wrote this all very clearly. Likewise, also, there's Mikkyo Dorje's direct disciple, Pazlo Trungpa, a great text, The Feast for Scholars, which is well known. And this also describes how Mikkyo Dorje's built statues and how many, it describes clearly how many monasteries he did. And among them, for example, talk about it in just in general terms, in the Feast for Scholars, what it says, the Dharma History by Tepazo Tango, what it says in here is that during the Mikkyo Dorje's life, there were many new monasteries that were there. There are many new monasteries that were built during that time. For example, the King of Zhang provided the support to reform the Kansa Chöde. And there was also a place of Dabampambo. And he also had made a new monastery there. Also, there's La Lama Yundan Wangju, who built a new monastery. And Rutu Ramchen Sunam Dangyal built a new monastery. Likewise, there's a place Kawa Karpora, right? So in this area of Kawa Karpora, there is Champa Gansa built a new monastery. And this is also Cheo, in the region of Cheo. And this place called Changmo Namso. There's a Lama or an Indian place. This is in the area of Kan. And they built a great monastery called Humputse. This is a great Kajun, large monastery. And there are many such monasteries, and I don't need to recite or read each of them. Now, at that time, Mikkyo Dorje had many students, and his sponsors built many different Karma Kagyu monasteries. There are quite a few that they built. And in particular, the King of Zhang sent 500 monasteries to Zhang to become monks. And so he would send 500 new monks every year to Zhang, to the central Tibet. The next I'd like to talk about the ones that supported, the one that Mikkyo Dorje himself sponsored and built, and the shedras and the practice centers. And I'd like to list each of these for you now. So this is it. So this is the ones that I mentioned before, the Mikkyo Dorje were founded by students or sponsors who are connected to Mikkyo Dorje. So what I'd speak next about the ones that Mikkyo Dorje himself directly provided the support, the ones he gave the financial support to build these monasteries. And so quite a few of these are shedras, and there are also a few meditation centers. And this is in the list of accomplishments. I'm taking this based on that text. And it says Ta Sura Dong Shedra, that he founded, and that had 250 permanent members of the Sangha. There's a Karma Gaza Shunglet Ling, which had 120 Sangha members who stayed there permanently. And Tokyo, which is in probably Tsang, here at the Karma Vinaya Center, he made this new Shedra, and it had 250 members of the Sangha. Then there's also Dabo Gugur, This is Dapo is in the region of Tibet, right? And then there's an area of Gokur. There is a monastery called Karma Jume Ling that he founded. Now, you didn't say exactly how many Sangha members are. There's also Kuro in Dapo. There's a place called Dapo Shedaplin, or Karma Shedaplin. And this is a Shedra. And this Shedra are taught both Sutra and Tantra. So this is a Shedra where both Sutra and Tantra were studied, and it had 300 Sangha members. So these are the ones who stayed there, who lived there permanently. And there's Rati. And there's a monastery called Ganden Ling. It's a Shedra. And it had 300 students. And then there's Tongu Rinchen Ling, and that is a Shedra. And it doesn't say how many Sangha members there were there. Then there's Gargi Yangyua. So Gar, which Dunda says, the Karma Gaj at the Great Encampment. And this had the Yang and Sura, the upper and the lower. The two, the Yangri one, the Suriwa. Yangriwa primarily means the people who are doing the Mahamudra and six yogas. So this is the organization that they're part of. So there's the Gargi Yariwa, and that had 250 meditators, and the Suriwa had 100 meditators, over 100 meditators. And the younger one, Suriwa, five times later, I can give an explanation of that. And there's Gompo Tse Ladhang, where we had a new retreat center. And there are over 200 Sangha members there. In Chatsagong, he had a new retreat center, which had over 100 retreatants. In Kompo Nokpo, there was over 100 retreatants. And Po, which is also in Kompo, it's an area of Kompo. It's called Yamez. He had made a new retreat center there. And there was a retreat center with 150 retreatants. There's in Chori, he had a new retreat center. It doesn't say how many retreatants. And then it says the Yariwa and Shamakure. I'm going to talk about in the old days, the Karma, great Karma Kaje was the encampment. And then it had the secondary ones, the Bamara's encampment and the Gyatsa encampments. And there were also other encampments that were sort of like secondary. Happens. And in the second encampment, it's actually like a secondary one, and that also had a Yangri retreat center. And then Uman Takar, he also had a retreat center. And then there was a Tantra college. So as I said, in the Great Encampment, there was also the meditation centers, the Yangri and Suriwa, and they had 300 or 400 people meditating. And they also had like a monastic college. And the monastic college was a primary place to study the tantras. It was a shedra for studying the tantras. And this is part of the Great Encampment. There was also a place to study the sutras in the Kaji Buddhism. So the Great Encampment was a very large organization, and it didn't stay in one place. Instead, it went to various different places, encamping in different places and living in tents. This is why it's called an encampment. And so within this Great Encampment, there did all of the different parts. It had the centers for study and practice, so forth. It's a very large explanation. There's also Shokang, this is probably in Kongpo, and he also started a new Tantra college there, and that had over 100 Sangha members. And so he established many new shedras and retreat centers, and Mikdorje himself provided the resources for them. This is not counting the ones that his students and sponsors made, the ones that he actually sponsored himself and that he actually established himself. So he established quite a few of these, and with these, most of them have at the minimum of minimum, no less than 100. The largest ones are like 300. There were a few that were larger, as it says in the Feast for Scholars. So what it also says in the Feast for Scholars is, Rinkyo Dorje was like the union of the activity of all the incarnations of their economies, karmapas. And there are places where there previously had been Karmakadri monasteries, but he spread the karma teachings, Karmakadri teachings there, Rajun Zangomchuk. The place where he was born is born in Ngomchu. There had been a prophecy that there were that the Karmapa teachings would prove there, and according to the prophecy, Mungu Dorje was born there, and because of this, the Karma Council teachings flourished there. Likewise, in the area of Tsang, there weren't any Karmakadri monasteries before then. It's only when Mungu Dorje arrived. There had been previous prophecies by the previous incarnations that there would be many, that the teachings would spread in Zang. And so when Mungu Dorje arrived, that then they spread widely in Zang. Likewise, in the south area, there prophecies of the teaching would appear in the south. And this is when the Karmakadri teachings were first established in southern Tibet as well. In this way, during the time of Rinkyo Dorje, there was a great increase in the number of monasteries, and they flourished greatly. So it was a great... And there's a power for this growth was, if you gather all the power of some of them, it's even like it's been more than combining several of them together. Is greater, that's how it was. Likewise, if you think about his deeds in terms of works, Karmapakshi, if in the old days, his collected works contained as many volumes as all the texts in the country that had been translated. So it's like sometimes they have 103 or 110 these days, right? So he had a collected work, so it's just that the same number of volumes. However, at the time of Pazula Chöngwa, then only 16 volumes of Karmapakshin's works were still extant. But Mikyo Dorje's collected works had over 30 volumes. So for this reason, he had the greatest, the most influential activity of his speech. It was probably Rinkyo Dorje who was the most influential and the most effective with his speech. Thus, he had many disciples who gave up on this life. They had perfected their devotion for the guru. He had many such students. And so in terms of them, Rinkyo Dorje also had very vast activity. Is very different from this, as it said. And this is how it is explained in the Feast for Scholars. Likewise, as I mentioned before, there's Rinkyo Dorje's list of accomplishments. If you look at his collected works, you'll see it. And prominently lists the great masters that he studied with, how he made connections of accumulation and purification with them, the teachings he received on the scriptures from them, and how many students he had from his through teaching and writing, and then he just got the particular qualities of each of these that each of these students had. He looks at what statues and so forth of the three jewels he built. He lists all of these, and I think this is actually a very crucial document. So I think. So if you have an opportunity to read Rinkyo Dorje's collected works, I think it's good to read this. So Rinkyo Dorje himself, he's established so many Kadri monasteries, so some people would criticize or said all sorts of things about it. And what they said is that
Tibu di idar midar
is only seeing what it can do to only spread the Kagyu teachings. And that's not good. It's impure idea. Actually, he should try to support the teachings of all the lineages. Well, Mikyudoji is always promoting the Karmakamsan teachings, and he's working hard for those. But this is a sign that he has impure intentions and actions. But here, what his student Sangye Paldrup says is, when people speak like that, is that they're only thinking about their own tradition. So when he's saying that he's only supporting his own teaching, the tradition, what does that mean? Mikyudoji did it for himself. What his own school was like, was all the sentient beings throughout space who have been his, thinking of them, and he thinks of all the sentient beings as being the same as his own kind of mother. And so he considered them all as being his own school or his own guide. He didn't like divide it into groups and said one said some were their friends and some the enemies. He had nothing like that. He considered that all the beings in all the throughout world were in his side, in his group, and were among his friends. And so these days, instead of doing it, some people think these days, so some people have act out of attachment aversion, they have resentments about the teaching, other teachings. And some people destroy the temples, or they destroy the supports of the representation of the body, speech, and mind. He said this shouldn't be allowed. And the best, if one should do, if you have the teach, it's best if there's the true teachings. That's the best. Even if there's no one can actually uphold the teachings, then if at least there can be people who can have uphold a reflection or an image of the teachings, then that is also very important. And basically, upholding and spreading and propagating the Buddhist teachings, that's what he was doing. It was what he's interested in. He didn't think that there is only doing it for only his own school. He said in the school of the Buddha, there's only one teaching of the Buddhas. There's not an own school and others. If we do it of others, as you say, then if you look at the teaching of all the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, you say that all of their activities are faulty. For example, in Tibet, you have all of the teachings, teachings of all the lineages engage in spreading and increasing the teaching their own schools, and they would all be at fault for doing so. So, when we uphold our own teachings of our own tradition, then other people look at it and might think that we're doing it only for our own side. Think that we're sectarian, we're doing it only for our own view. That's how people think. But actually, who is upholding the teachings of the Buddha? So, whatever teachings we are upholding, preserving, and teaching, we need to preserve them and propagate them. We shouldn't recognize some as me teaching, some as I say that if we take them all as being teachings, which we recognize some as being teaching and some as not being, then this is a question of acting out of attachments and aversions, and that becomes a very difficult situation. So that's how it is. So I think that's basically it for today. So now, I thought of that for the fifth time in the next few days, and I think if we speak about this, then there's Mikyudoji's own. Mikyudoji himself, during the first part of his life, in the areas of central Tibet and Kham, he founded many monasteries. But these days, we don't see the monasteries that were founded by Mikyudoji. We can't see them. We don't hear about monasteries that were founded. So what happened to these monasteries? In the long period of history, there's been a lot of changes in Tibetan history. And so within this, many of the monasteries that that Mukhi Dorje have founded because of the course of time. They've undergone a lot of changes, and basically none of them are left. Or even if they are left, then they are in a sort of different situation than before. And so if we have time the other day, I think if there's some time, I speak about a few of the monasteries, what their situation was in the past and what their current situation is. And I think if I explain this, and I think this is something that can give you a little bit of a, give you a sort of a broader understanding. And I think it'll help you understand better in the educational. So we're going to take about a 20-minute break, and then after that, we're going to have our we'll have our texts. We will recite the dedications and Tara prayers.